covering all the news from every dark corner of the universe. SliceOfSciFi.com.
Hey, greetings everyone to another Slice of Sci-Fi. I am Michael R. Menengay.
I'm Sam Roberts.
I'm Megan Zier.
And I'm Tim Adamick.
Awesome. This may be a quick show or it may be a really long show. I don't know. It just depends on where we go with it. But we are going to dissect deeply Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Which means...
Spoilers!
If you haven't seen it, or if you haven't seen past the first or second episode,
get ready because like we're going to talk about. Right.
I'm super spoiled today.
We're spoiling Tim like crazy.
Yeah, I haven't seen any of it.
He hasn't seen any of it. Megan's only seen the pilot.
I've seen the first.
We're pretty close.
Four, right? Yeah. I just missed this week's, which Mike tells me was the bestest ever.
So far, the best all the way around. Okay. So there you go. So if you're not wanting to be spoiled, or maybe you want to be spoiled and know what you're up for. I'm thinking that we're close enough in this series that we can spoil the heck out of the beginning of this and you're still going to be fine.
Yeah, come on.
Because
yeah,
there's a lot
more. It's only like five episodes in. So,
it's five episodes in. And I will kick it off and say that I was not super impressed with it at the beginning.
I was not.
I was going to ask you guys. I've heard that it's largely meh.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It really was. It's typical Whedon in every sense of the word in that... It takes a few episodes for it to really ramp up. Mm-hmm.
But wait for it, because then you have Dr. Horribles, which mm-hmm. was fantastic right out of the gate, and everything clicked. And maybe it's because he used a lot of people that he had already worked mm-hmm. with in it.
But
you have the typical awkwardness in the first several episodes.
Different context, though.
Different context, right? But you have, it seemed a little forced. It was just a little awkward. It was trying too hard to be Whedon-like.
Well,
they
were trying too hard, period. You could tell everybody on that set, the first several episodes, they're so tense.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell they're pushing so hard because this has to be a mm-hmm. hit.
It's not just Whedon, it's Avengers.
It's Avengers. It's Iron Man 3. It's mm-hmm. Iron Man 2. It's Iron Man 1. It's Captain America. Mm-hmm. It's everything.
Over 1 million Facebook likes before the show even premiered.
So, and, I mean, the pressure to perform and succeed on this show was staggering.
And that's why I think Whedon's the wrong person for it.
I don't think so.
I do. You've got Joss Whedon, who has had let's go ahead and be honest, he's had a spotty track record.
That's true.
He did fantastic with Buffy.
Mm-hmm.
Firefly was sunk largely because of Fox.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Dollhouse pretty much sucked.
Yeah.
Dollhouse was problematic for the first half, but it got really, really good.
I think
if Joss had been bigger, like he is now with Agents mm-hmm. of S.H.I.E.L.D., I'm seeing Dollhouse and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. parallels.
It was Joss's fault and Joss's essentially direction that made the first nine episodes of the first season the exact same show.
Yeah.
Mm. You saw the same thing over and over and over again.
Yes. Dollhouse was really problematic at that time.
He lost his way with it. And mm-hmm.
then it was super rushed at the end.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I think
because he had to be.
I think mm-hmm. Dollhouse suffered dramatically. I know we're getting completely off.
That's okay.
Yeah. No, we're
Let's
not.
Get
but,
rid of S.H.I.E.L.D. There we go.
But Dollhouse suffered dramatically because Joss wasn't big enough. And mm-hmm. he was not able to do the things that he wanted to in those first episodes because they were too edgy for TV, and everybody was too skittish.
I'm going to say it. Every time he gets into the cool ongoing arc and gets away from the episodic contained stuff, he gets better.
Yeah.
When
mm-hmm.
he's just doing the contained formulaic stuff, it's formulaic and annoying.
Mm-hmm. And
right?
That's why
but as soon as it got into the Alpha storyline mm-hmm.
right.
and all that, you know, and what happened further along, right?
And that's what's happened with Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah.
right now. It really is.
So it's finally got good, is what you're saying?
This last episode was amazing.
Okay.
It was really, really good because we got some answers. We got a really great story that's starting to get interesting. And the people are starting to gel. That's the
important part.
That's the big problem is that a lot of these characters that came together they were not gelling for me.
And let me say, Lone Wolf Agent Dude, he's the worst actor on the show.
Truly.
Like, he may get comfortable. I don't know if he's been in a lot of stuff before, right? Even from the beginning, when everything's a little awkward, Agent Coulson is the best one on there.
Absolutely.
He's the most experienced actor. I mean, that guy has worked with David Mamet to Joss Whedon. Like, he's all over the place, right? He has a lot of great experience. And so he feels the most natural and in it. So these, like, I have seen gradual improvements, right, through the through the first four episodes. And so I really did expect it to get better and eventually settle in. So it's nice to hear that that happens.
The biggest thing that I think is, I hope that they get away from, although it looks like this is going to be an ongoing extreme arc because it's going to be our bad guy, is the extremist thing.
Yeah.
The extremist quote trope is the whole story, and that's where they're going with it. So I don't know.
I think it's cool because they have to reference the movies. So they do stuff like they like a whole episode was about an extremist type thing, right? And they do things like, you know, spoiler, Nick Fury's in one episode briefly. And like, you know, all sorts. Sorry, we warned you. You know, and so there's little stuff like that. And they reference like, you know, one of the episodes is about finding some sort of unknown type of alien whatever. And somebody was like, wow, what happened last time you found one? And he was like, it was a hammer.
Yes.
You know, so there's stuff like that. That's
it's
nice.
It's world building. It's nice.
Right.
It is really great world building. I mean, they are they are taking all the movies and they're putting them together. And
it's like bringing comic books to television and movies.
It truly is.
And that's like, obviously comic book geeks love that. Otherwise, we wouldn't buy comic books every week.
Right.
So, question for all of you then, having seen some of this. How much of your criticism is just the fact that you expect so much more out of Joss Whedon? If you had had this from, say, a relatively unknown, or a Stan Lee coming in, or...
Well, if it was M. Night, I would be impressed as hell.
Okay, but
there's that. So let's think about this, because the other point to make is Joss is producing this, but the really the hands-on people
are
Jed, his brother, and Marissa, who's Jed's wife, right?
I believe,
right. So they're really the showrunners.
But
they've worked with Joss a lot. Absolutely. It's all a very certain kind of style.
And you can't tell me that even though Joss is just producing, that he's not in there going, Jed,
sure
this
is.
Sucks.
Well,
know,
and there's...
Or do this different, or, you know.
And he's certainly lining up storylines, right? But I got to say, I think I would be just as nitpicky because I was the first person to say, like, Arrow has a lot of I like about it, but there's some cheesy stuff that annoys me, and it took me a while to really love it. So, but I tend to be the more nitpicky, although there's a certain class of soapy ridiculousness that I'm all for. But if you're not going for the soapy ridiculousness and you come off cheesy, then I have a hard time with that. And that did this a little at the beginning.
Right.
I don't know.
So, I mean, our hacker geek girl is...
Let's talk stereotypes.
I mean, talk is stereotypes.
Really?
And she's got... There she is right there. And she is...
Wow.
She's got her big secret, which was revealed this episode. We finally found out what it was. And I was hoping that it was going to be a whole lot more than, I need to find my mommy and daddy. But that's what it was.
Ugh.
That's what it is. That's her big secret. And S.H.I.E.L.D. evidently has all the information on the cover-up and why she lost her parents. And they're holding all the information.
Yawn.
And it was like, okay, so who are they? So evidently her parents are something, you know...
They're Peter Parker's parents, right?
Or something. Who knows? They've got some mystery around them. So it was kind of interesting to see how that worked. However,
that would be awesome. She could be Spider-Girl.
Even though the whole premise was kind of a groaner, what really was nice for me was the cast gelled for the first time in this episode because everybody kind of came into their own there. Mm-hmm. So that's good, and it gives me a lot of promise and a lot of hope for the rest of this series.
I will say one way in which I judge this harsher than I would a non-Whedon show is the stereotypes and the generic characters. Mm. I expect a Whedon show to turn those stereotypes sideways or on their, you know what I mean? I expect, you know, when they, like, the classic example is Firefly, when the captain and Zoe's husband are both captured by the evil guy, and she tries to buy them out, and the evil guy's like, you can only have one. You have to choose between your husband and the captain, and before he can even get that sentence out, she's like, I'll take my husband.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Like, it was supposed to be like an agonizing moment. And she's like, I'll take my husband.
And she's like, oh no, I'll let you finish.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Did you want to be more dramatic? You know what I mean? That's kind of like the classic.
The witty dialogue.
But we don't have the characters that may seem, or the things that seem stereotypical, have so far been pretty stereotypical. Mm-hmm. And I expect more than that from a Whedon show. So I am judging it very harshly on that.
But see, and I think that comes to what I'm starting to see as a pattern here is Whedon's about 50-50 when it comes to network television at this point.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And I really think that that's more a constraint of network television, and he should not be doing...
Get on cable.
He shouldn't be doing TV at best. At worst, he should be doing A&E, HBO, something like that. Mm-hmm. I really think if he constrains himself to movies, his three-part act thing with, mm-hmm. with Dr. Horrible,
yeah, Dr.
or
Horrible.
The Avengers mm-hmm. was fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
What was the... Why can't I remember? Cabin
Much
in
Ado?
The Woods?
Oh, Cabin in the Woods.
Yeah, even Much Ado About
Cabin
Nothing
in
was
the
fantastic.
Woods, absolutely.
But when you give him
because
a
all
limit,
that great, witty, and really intelligent banter and dialogue, mm-hmm. it's missing. I mean, there's some of it. They
a little bit.
They get to the edge of it being Whedon awesome, and it... Mm. Falls flat.
That's a bummer.
I see it mostly coming from Coulson and the hacker chick.
Yeah.
And so I'm hoping it develops as they find, because it takes some time. The writers take some time to find the voices of the characters to sort them out, like within the dynamic. So, you know, but I will tell you, I would maybe not give it this long if it was somebody other than
that's true. That's what I'm wondering.
That's true. I'd probably give up on it.
Yeah, and that leads to bigger and bigger disappointment, I think, with Whedon.
Mm-hmm. But here's the other thing, and I don't know if this is good or bad, but I have the sense that we wouldn't have as long for them to figure it out and for the show to get good if it wasn't a little generic, because this has to have mass appeal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It has to be something like, so part of my problem with Revolution, left turn, is that it's a little blah, a little generic. It's not quite edgy enough for me. Everybody's a little too pretty, so I'm kind of in it, but not really. But it's actually really popular. Lots of people watch it. Mm. It goes beyond just genre fans. And I think in order for this show to be successful, it had to take the Avengers fans who are not like just your built-in nerds and have that popular audience. And I think that broader appeal, it needs that in order to continue surviving. So maybe it being a little generic, so it sucks people in, and then it gets more Whedon-y as it goes on, and it's already got the audience it's drawing along with
it.
See, and that's why I think he needs to get his ass off of network television, because... Mm-hmm. You already saw with Avengers, gigantic comic book movie that is really an incredibly ridiculous premise for a comic. You've got the, I mean,
it shouldn't have been as big as it was.
And he turned this into a brilliant movie that had gigantic mass appeal.
Yes.
If you would just leave him alone and let him do it, he'd do it fine. But you can't do that on network TV.
You know, you bring up a good point, because on the extra features on Iron Man 3, they have. Let's see, it's Bill Maher, The View, and I think, who is it? Is it Colbert? I can't remember. There's several real life people reporting on the incidents that are happening inside of Iron Man and inside of Avengers, and the alien attack and all this stuff. And to see these people that you're used to seeing talking about real life and real serious things, talking about these unbelievable thing, it really puts a fine point on how absurd what was going on in these movies really was. Mm-hmm.
But the key,
and the fact that it worked.
The key to Whedon is he takes the absurd and he grounds it in emotion. Mm-hmm. So even if something as ridiculous as Buffy the Vampire Slayer was all this really great coming of age sort of emotional thing, and he could have this whole absurd vampire thing happen, and then there was the episode like The Body where her mom dies.
Oh my gosh.
You know what I mean? And she's got a stake of vampire in the morgue. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, he takes this ridiculous and he grounds it in emotion and it becomes real, and then it becomes more important, and you want to hang on to it.
And that's what I'm seeing here.
You have to let him do it. And Tim may be right, because there's network constraints. There's that mass appeal thing, you know?
And then that's a very comic book thing to do, too, because all the writers of comic books, they know they're writing about people in their underwear fighting crime, and they have to take it seriously. And they do.
Avengers goes
and you buy it.
Beyond that, though, it's not just a character in his underwear. It's seven characters who've never seen each other.
Right? Which is very comic booky, because you have the entire Marvel universe. And so now these people in their underwear who fight crime talk to each other like it's totally normal.
Exactly.
Like,
right.
I just bought the Abomination the other day.
Right. But that's why the classic Joss Whedon thing of killing a character you love really worked. Because it did, right? In the movie, all of a sudden, it's for reals. Like, and they're having a good time, and there's, like, you know, Tony Stark and Bruce Banner banter, and you're loving the chemistry between the two science-y dudes, and then Coulson dies, and you're like, shit.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I love the fact that that is continuing. And we're getting that in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. That you know, he basically was staked through. And they talk about that all the time. And there's something major there.
I like the Coulson story.
I love the Coulson story. That's going to be awesome. The centipede thing is kind of kooky, but it again, it's that absurd that I think they can make work if they ground it right.
If they get out of his way, and I'm afraid that a network television show on primetime is not going to get out of his way.
Although,
Fox
will. If anybody can force him to get out of his way, it's Marvel and the bigness of the audience eventually bring along. And so far, I mean, this thing, it's got a full season renewal, right? So it's picked up for a full season. So maybe now they have time to stretch their legs a little bit. I don't know how far into production they are, right? But they still have a number of episodes that hadn't been fully written and produced, so there may be some time on the back half to then take the regular folks that they've brought and bring them along into the Whedon-ness of it all.
Now we have you trapped.
And I'm going to say it, the bigger your audience is and the better your ratings are, the more the next work's going to leave you alone.
And that's it. Is we need the ratings. We need people to watch this. Please stick with it. Don't give up on this show because it really needs it. Because here's the piece that's really annoying me about the show, and I'm hoping that audience and ratings is going to solve, and that is we don't see enough really cool toys.
There's been a little more.
A little bit, but not enough.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the whole thing about S.H.I.E.L.D., Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Yeah. If you read the comics, if you are any kind of a fan, they have every cool toy you can imagine.
What's the time frame? Is the time frame after the movie?
Yes.
It's right after Iron Man 3.
So they already should have the hovering.
They should have helicarriers.
Yes. I mean, well, he's got a flying classic car.
Yeah. So there you go.
Here's what I do like. I like Fitzsimmons, right? Mm-hmm. I think those two can be fun.
The whole
little Fitzsimmons, right? One's name is Fitz, the other one's a Simmons, so they're referred to as Fitzsimmons.
Right.
And I really enjoyed...
See, that looks Doctor Who.
It does.
Well, they're outfits. But I'm going to say...
they're English too, right? Are they both English?
They're both English.
I mean, that's a very Doctor Who look.
It is. Mm-hmm. It is.
And they are very Doctor Who because they are... their banter is the best in the show.
It is. It is. And the other thing I liked is because I'm behind one episode, so I didn't see this latest one that Mike said really improved. But I thought the one before that with the former operative that Coulson had trained, right?
Yes.
I thought that was actually... I mean, that was the best one that I've seen up to now because I felt some emotion there with Agent Coulson and how he handled that and how the team reacted to it. And then I thought she was really good at subtly displaying the emotion of what she had been through, you know? And so that was the most emotionally attached I've been to an episode since it started. And so for me, it was like, oh, all right, maybe it can get there. So I'm excited to see this week and see, you know, if I feel the same way that it's like more steps along.
Yeah, I think it's going to improve. So, okay.
Is that enough?
Is that enough on
this? Well, darn near 18 minutes, but
I have a quick question then. Ming-Na, because she's my favorite.
I love
her.
And
she didn't have a whole lot in the first episode. Does she get better?
She gets better.
Ass kicker, which is fun by itself, but then she's one of those, she's slowly going to let it in, so it's going to be a slow burn with her, but the ass kickery is awesome.
That's a bad picture.
And the big the only problem that I have with her are they're not giving her enough good lines.
Nobody ever gives Ming-Na enough.
She's super stoic. She is so stoic as she does not say a lot, and they have not been able to really break her personality out yet.
I think they're being super slow with it because if they break her personality out, I don't think it'll feel authentic because they've set her up as being walled off.
Yeah, that's true.
I think it was actually, they had her agree to go back in the field officially with combat faster than I thought.
That was this episode.
Well, the previous episode, she said, fine, you can put me back in combat.
Yeah, but they actually put her in this time. And what I'm waiting for is for them to actually break her loose. And I want to see that. I want to see her personality really come through.
Yeah.
They need to do it right now, really fast, because she's like my biggest meh character right now.
I'm bigger. It's the guy. Meh.
The guy is meh too.
So that You got to put that picture back up there, Megan.
The one of Ming-Na.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So are we really saying that in episode 5, there's the musical episode already?
That was the first episode. Yeah. She kicked butt.
Yeah.
I was like, please let Ming-Na be awesome because she's awesome.
She is.
I think there's
awesome.
A lot of potential there, but we'll have to see.
Absolutely.
So we've been pontificating for like 20 minutes, but we want to hear what you guys think. So make sure you get in either the iPhone app and video your response or call Mike on what number is that, Mike?
Why, that is 206-339-TREK. That's 206-339-8735. Please send us your feedback and your comments. And, if nothing else, go to our Facebook page and
start a discussion there. Yeah.
Start a discussion there. That's the best way to do it. We'll be back with more TV geeking. Our next episode is going to be in-depth on what else is going on the season that you should be watching.
But I have a list.
And we've got a lot.